Tim Thompson. I'll be introducing our speaker. And Jim Wertz, Dr. Jim Wertz, I think he's a good friend and a wonderful presenter. I saw this presentation on the Jefferson Education Society, and I'm for great things. Jim is a professor in the Department of Journalism and Public Relations here at the university. He's also the director of the Honors Program, and he is the campaign manager for Jay Brenneman for Erie Mayor. So, which is starting to get heated up a little bit. He's a busy guy. He's also a very active member with the Jefferson Education Society, has done a number of presentations, which I have felt very lucky to see. Not only that in Erie, but he's also on the board of Knife Erie and the Erie Philharmonic. So he's a busy guy. He's a contributing editor of the Erie Reader magazine. Jim is the right guy to talk on this subject of fake news because he's owned his own production company in the past. He was also a production manager at WICU, the NBC affiliate in Erie, so he's got a rich background in media. He teaches TV production here, advanced digital media, and advanced electronic journalism as well. And in the spirit of tonight's presentation, I also have to let you know that he once beat Kellyanne Conway in a debate in high school. He's been around, I tell you. He also invented the word tweet. So I'm talking to the guy who did that. And he was really the first one to write sad on a tweet as well. So I give you Jim Wertz.
As you might have guessed, there were a lot of alternative facts in that introduction. My bio to the side, but the creation of the internet and all things digital probably is not a completely accurate statement. I just want to preface tonight by letting you know I've had a cold for the past 2 weeks, and I've been my voice has been beaten. So if I start to get soft and you can't hear me, please let me know, and I will throw a microphone on. But I'm generally too loud and exuberant for a microphone in a room like this, and so we'll just start there and go forward. I appreciate you all coming out tonight for this presentation of faking the news, lying in an age of illiterate consumption. We're all guilty in some respects of not perhaps doing enough of our own homework in researching the things that we see, in researching the things that we read, in understanding the value of sources and source material in kind of our everyday modes of media consumption. Since the 2016 presidential election, the idea of fake news has taken a paramount position in American society and certainly in the American democratic process. It is not likely that this is a concept that will go away anytime soon. It is not likely that it is a concept that is easily reconciled, either by us as consumers, by the media as producers, or by those who are sourcing the media, our elected officials and the people that work for them. I want to begin tonight's presentation with a clip from a news conference that occurred just about a month ago. You may recall it was one of the first news conferences of the Trump administration. As far as we know, President Trump had not told many people within the White House that he was going to hold this press conference on this particular morning. He came out and he began to lambaste and chastise the media for their coverage of events.
I'm here today to update the American people on the incredible progress that has been made in the last 4 weeks since my inauguration. The press has become so dishonest that if we don't talk about it, we are doing a tremendous disservice to the American people. I turn on the TV, open the newspapers, and I see stories of chaos. Chaos. Yet it is the exact opposite. This administration is running like a fine-tuned machine. President Putin called me up very nicely to congratulate me on the win of the election. He then called me up extremely nicely to congratulate me on the inauguration, which was terrific. And the leaks are absolutely real. The news is fake because so much of the news is fake. But I'm having a good time. Tomorrow they will say, Donald Trump rants and raves at the press. I'm not ranting and raving. I'm just telling you, you know, you're dishonest people. But I'm not ranting and raving. I love this. I'm having a good time doing it. But tomorrow the headlines are going to be, Donald Trump rants and raves. I'm not ranting and raving. We had Hillary Clinton give Russia 20% of the uranium in our country. You know what uranium is, right? Think of nuclear weapons and other things, like lots of things are done with uranium, including some bad things. Politically, it would be unpopular for a politician to make a deal. I can't believe I'm saying I'm a politician, but I guess that's what I am now.
There's been a report out that 48 bomb threats have been made against Jewish centers all across the country in the last couple of weeks. There are people who are committing anti-Semitic acts or threatening to.
You see, he said he's going to ask a very simple, easy question. And it's not. It's not. Not a simple question. Not a fair question. Okay, sit down. I understand the rest of your question. So here's the story of us. Number one, I am the least anti-Semitic person that you've ever seen in your entire life. We lived in a divided nation. And I am going to try. I will do everything within my power to fix that. I want to thank everybody very much. It's a great honor to be with you. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. There is some analysis that goes along with that clip, but I'll leave it to you to look it up and come back to it. Most of what we've heard, not only from this administration, but throughout the campaign cycle, has been a matter of, if not outright lying, to a great extent, simply ignoring facts, right? Just simply ignoring facts. Now, ignoring facts, and in some cases just subverting the truth, has long been a constant variable in American political discourse. The practice is so embedded in our political DNA that the founders of our democracy made the rights of the press one of the few non-governmental professional references in the Constitution and the Bill of Rights. Now, given the relationship of politicians and the press today, and the effect of citizen journalists and social media starlets on big government and big media, I often wonder if legitimizing the professional practice of the press in the First Amendment wasn't simply a bold tactic that was used to keep the pamphleteers in check. The role of the free press in the democratic state is a paradoxical one. It's caught between the responsibility to cover and critique the very subjects whom they rely upon for access to the information necessary to ply their trade. In his thoughtful analysis of the news media, published in 1996, the journalist James Fallows, who's a former speechwriter for Jimmy Carter and knows his way around the American governmental system, described the reporter's purpose as, quote, to view society from as many levels as possible. Among his goals, Fallows wrote, is to let readers see more than they could with their own eyes. But in doing so, journalists often expose tensions among the facts they present, the subjects related to those facts, and the audience that receives them. In the revolutionary era, reporters exalted the cult of Washington in an attempt to ease nationalist concerns that their differential leader would one day become the symbol of a failed democratic experiment. As American expansion crossed to the Great Plains, it was journalists who balanced the fear of the savage with the promise of the frontier. And whether muckrakers and yellow journalists, advocates for war in the name of peace and humanity, or critics of war profiteers with the same motivation, journalists have shocked and inspired because even in the face of criticism for the way they presented facts and told a story, those facts and those stories were revered and respected. As Fallows concluded, journalism is the main tool we have for keeping the world's events in perspective. It's the main source of agreed-upon facts we can use in public decisions. The excesses of journalism have been tolerated because no other institution can provide the benefits that journalism can. Today, however, we find ourselves in an unprecedented era in which journalism, both as an industry and as a practice, is being undermined by the refutation of fact with fiction in a phenomenon that we now refer to as fake news. Before I continue, I want to establish some rather non-fake premises on which we can scaffold during the rest of the evening together. Operationally, let me tell you that there is no such thing as fake news. The term is oxymoronic by virtue of the fact that news, as both a genre of consumption and as a popular and historical artifact, is inherently fact-based. If a story is not based in fact, I'm here to tell you that it cannot be news in any way. Rather, at that point, it becomes a form of deception, which may or may not be shaped by a relative truth. And even truth in this case is philosophically separate from fact, and in many ways, it's indifferent to fact. Now, that sentence alone is loaded. And as loaded as it is, it could shape the debate for several lifetimes, I fear. So I'm going to steer away from that argument and that discussion for another time. Perhaps a great talk for another academic festival from one of our philosophers. Instead, I want to talk about a few examples that illustrate just how news, how a fact-based mode of communication can become simply fake. For professional journalists, there are only a few ways that their work is compromised. One, fictional representations of newsworthy events or circumstances. How many of you remember the story of Janet Cook, or how many of you have ever heard of Janet Cook in classes? We've got a couple, all right? Anybody who's had class with me, I imagine. In September of 1980, The Washington Post published a story that Janet Cook had submitted about an 8-year-old heroin addict. His name was Jimmy, and he lived in a Washington, D.C. housing project. Her story was titled Jimmy's World, and Jimmy's World captured national attention. As it did, so did Janet Cook. The Post managing editor, some of you might know the name Bob Woodward, he was the Post managing editor at the time, submitted her piece for a Pulitzer Prize, the highest award in American journalism. It was a Pulitzer Prize for feature writing, which she was later awarded. From the time that the story was published, many of her co-workers had questioned the validity, the authenticity of her story. But the Post and its editors defended the story, and because of the picture that she painted of this 8-year-old's life, the public demanded that Jimmy be saved. D.C. Mayor Marion Barry, who some of you may know for other public news stories, and Police Chief Bertel Jefferson formed a task force comprised of D.C. police and social workers that spread out across the city to find this child. In the story, Cook wrote that Jimmy had been given heroin for the first time at the age of 5 by his mother's live-in boyfriend, who was a drug dealer. She also told us how Jimmy went to school motivated by the fact that if he learned how to do math well, that he could be a better drug dealer than his mom's boyfriend. He could be a better drug dealer than the man who taught him about drugs. She concluded the story by describing a scene in which Jimmy sat in a chair in his apartment and his mother's boyfriend put a needle in his arm, explaining to him that he was 8 now. He was soon going to have to learn how to do this for himself. You can imagine the empathy, the ire, the anger that people had for this situation. As Mary and Barry's crew spread out across the city, as task force were deployed, people wanted evidence that Jimmy existed. But when they arrived at the housing project where she said they lived, there was no Jimmy. He was nowhere to be found. Did they leave because of the press? That's the story that she told. But the less evidence there was for Jimmy, the more it looked like Janet Cook had indeed faked the news. Basic elements of Cook's story could not be verified. When her editors took her out to the housing project where she said they lived, they asked, well, which apartment was Jimmy's? She said to them, I can't remember. They all kind of looked the same. When they looked to verify sources, she says, well, I only talked to that one person, and I can't find him now. She, of course, talked to social workers and law enforcement. She didn't talk to
Eventually, both Marion Barry and Bertel Jefferson publicly challenged Janet Cook's story. At that point, Cook was immediately discredited and had to resign from the Washington Post. Ultimately, she said, yes, I made up the story, but Jimmy was a composite. He was a character that I built out of a number of stories so that I could communicate this problem in our society, this problem in our city. Perhaps most relevant to today's discussion is a statement released by Marion Barry in the wake of the scandal that he had been drawn into. Barry said, I am concerned and will continue to be concerned about the accuracy of information disseminated to our residents from the news media. Our residents deserve the most accurate and truthful accounting possible of both the activities of government and of events, trends, and changes taking place in our community. I believe that all responsible news media managers, as well as reporters, support that viewpoint, and that none of the media will condone misrepresentation, even in the name of dramatizing a problem in the country. Now, juxtapose that statement by a man who was put in the spotlight by this fiction. Similar dramatizations occurred at the New Republic when 25-year-old Stephen Glass, 25, all you future graduates, 25-year-old Stephen Glass made up sources, fabricated quotes, and sometimes even entire stories. In doing so, he duped a team of veteran editors, two guys by the name of Charles Lane and Michael Kelly, battle-tested reporters and editors, guys who could
smell BS from a mile away. And yet Stephen Glass somehow managed to get by them, not just one story, but a series of stories, tricking them into believing that his prose and his politics were pure. To carry out his illusion, Glass produced letterhead, wrote fake memos, submitted fake handwritten notes, created faxes and phone numbers, fake type notes with purposeful misspelling so it would look as though they were done in a rush. He would draw fake diagrams of buildings that he had been in, seating charts for meetings that never actually occurred. And he even went as far as to create fake voicemails from fictional characters. If there was someone that a fact checker or an editor needed to hear from, they would call and leave a voicemail on the editor's phone in the middle of the night. And when the editor or the fact checker would call back in the morning, there would be no one there to answer the call. Now, in the age of the internet, in the age of Google Voice, and the ability to create a million different fake accounts, this seems somewhat plausible and not all that laborious, right? But we're talking about the mid-90s here, before the age of the widespread internet, before the ability to create multiple accounts for yourselves. To have multiple phone numbers, you had to set up multiple phone lines. To have multiple voicemails, you had to have multiple answering machines, and you had to get people to leave outgoing messages on each one of those answering machines, right? This was an incredible labor on behalf of Stephen Glass. For him, creating the lie was much harder than reporting the truth. His crimes were different than those of Janet Cook, though, because his fabrications were, in many cases, simply created because the reality that he was writing about in his mind was more interesting than the reality that he found in the reporting space that he was given by his editors and by his publications. In one story, he talked about a hacker conference in Falls Church, Virginia. He went out and he covered the hacker conference. And the hackers supposedly were meeting close to the epicenter of our national security network to kind of thumb their nose at our national security apparatus. When his editors asked about this story, they took him out to the hotel where he claimed that the meeting had happened, that the convention had happened, and he made up stories on the spot based on what he was seeing at that moment. Oh yes, this meeting took place over here. There was a man that I talked to smoking behind that tree over there. And when no evidence was found for this meeting, when the editors couldn't verify what Glass was telling him, he said, I'm being done in by the hackers. The hackers are smarter than me. The hackers are smarter than you. They've gotten away with something. And it was the beginning of the end for Stephen Glass. Glass was writing mostly on tech-related issues and other kind of youthful fringe topics that were exciting to educated, upper, middle-class, middle-aged audience at a time, the mid-90s, when the average person, the average consumer, if you will, was not yet all that internet savvy. For those of you that are too young to remember, we were still sticking AOL disks in the computer to connect to dial-up internet. So, savage. We were not yet media literate for the digital age, and apparently neither were his editors. But both of these cases, both Cook and Glass, in addition to later plagiarism by Jason Blair at the New York Times, and most recently Sabrina Erdely's artistic license in Rolling Stone, represent failures in fact-checking and breakdowns of the editorial process that is biased toward the success of its talent, and naturally and rightfully so. It wasn't a collapse of journalism as an institution. Now contrast these episodes with non-journalistic fiction that is promoted in a number of ways, sometimes promoted as legitimate news. Stories like this come in a number of forms, including satire, which is often humorous and biting, opinion that comes without factual merit, right? When we think about opinion pieces, and I'm an opinion writer, we can write opinion that is just us and what we're thinking, and we say whatever we want, and we put it out there in the world, and we have a vehicle for that now on the internet. No one's fact-checking us, no one's questioning us. Or we can put out opinion pieces that are based in factual, that have factual merit to them, right? So we're talking about opinion that is not based in factual content. Distortions of factual news items, and we saw this a lot during the 2016 presidential election, where we would take, someone would take an actual news item, change one or two elements in that story, make it a fake news item, but it was dressed up properly, it looked real, it looked accurate, it may or may not have originated with a credible source, and yet somehow, many of us, not just Americans, but in the world, failed to see, failed to recognize that we were being duped. And of course, there are simply the outright lies. Now, when we talk about satire, it might be something absurdist, like this headline from The Onion, where the world agrees just to take down the internet until we figure out what it's good for. Man, college students didn't like that idea. Other forms of non-journalistic fictions might derive from these base opinions. This list is of the top 10 fake news stories in 2016 based on Facebook engagements. Now that might mean that somebody clicked on the story to click through to the story, right? It means that a user interacted with that story on Facebook. So it was more than just what was in the news feed. The number one story of 2016, President Obama signs an executive order banning the Pledge of Allegiance in schools nationwide. Now for a host of readers who believe that the president was a Muslim trying to undo American culture and civic pride, maybe this resonated, right? Number two story, a woman was arrested for defecating on her boss's desk after she won the lottery. Some of you laugh, you may have had that thought a time or two if you were to win the lottery. Right? So not unplausible, right? She sees her number come up, 10 million bucks, I'm going to the boss's office. Pope Francis, of course, never endorsed Donald Trump. Further down the list, at number eight, an FBI agent connected to the Clinton email scandal, which captured so much of our attention in 2016. Was found dead in a murder-suicide pact. Again, a little out there, a little outlandish, a little crazy. But for people who believe that the Clintons have been embroiled in scandal, some of which may have included murder and death, going back to the 1980s, this is a plausible story. Any Rage Against the Machine fans here? Anybody? Tell me you're too young even for Rage Against the Machine. Number nine, Rage Against the Machine to reunite and release an anti-Donald Trump album. That, of course, wasn't happening. But when the story was leaked, it seemed plausible. You remember that members of Rage Against the Machine united with members of Public Enemy in Cypress Hill to go and protest at the RNC in Cleveland this summer. So why wouldn't they get together to make a protest album against the Republican candidate? These stories range from relatively unbelievable to completely plausible. But like the fictional tales created by journalists like Janet Cook and the others, these stories contain some common core elements that are often embedded in popular fictional narratives. Number one, most of them are great stories. From Jimmy's World to the FBI murder-suicide, these are stories that are placed in settings in kind of American urban and suburban environments that are authentic. And they're stories that have been written as film fiction, may have been nominated for Academy Awards. They were that striking, that heart-wrenching. Number two, they all have some degree of credibility. Now, the stories themselves may not be credible, but there's an element of source credibility embedded in here. The sources are usually authoritative. The context is usually authentic. So if we think about the story of President Obama supposedly banning the Pledge of Allegiance, the context for that story was a White House press conference. Why wouldn't we believe that what was put out at a White House press conference is indeed fact? The last story on the list, police finding 19 white female bodies in freezers with Black Lives Matter carved into the skin, all had pictures associated, not pictures of that, of course, but pictures of meat lockers, maybe that were at a deer processing center or something. There was blood and there were freezers. That's what we saw. They could be from Jeffrey Dahmer crime scenes. Third, there were verification obstacles in all of the stories. In many fake news stories, there is only one source for a critical piece of information. If sources cannot be verified and re-verified, chances are good that the story itself probably is not accurate. You as a consumer can check this just by doing a Google search, capturing a part of a quote, capturing the name of a person, putting it into Google, and seeing what comes back. And the story is often told as part of a news event, like a crime scene, like that press conference. News events are believable as news, right? That context is authentic. We've come to know what we should expect from these types of presentations. These characteristics make stories more believable because they inhibit our decision-making processes by appealing toward our natural biases toward trust. Our trust in authority, our trust in authenticity, our empathy for the affected parties. But there are characteristics inherent in fake news that comes from a digital platform which weren't present in my earlier examples. Traditional sources like the Washington Post, the New Republic, and other media outlets quite simply had institutional trustworthiness. We've known them. We know these sources to be credible. We know their editorial process to be strong, not to say that it can't be thwarted in one way or another. But digital fake news typically does not come from a trustworthy news source. Rather, it's typically published by a source that hides behind a veil of distribution. What I mean by a veil of distribution is you see it on Facebook first. You see it on Twitter first. You don't have to go necessarily to the source to see the story. So we have this distribution veil. Many of you have probably said to a friend or to a teacher or written in a paper, I read it on Facebook. I saw it on Facebook. Not considering what the origin of that source actually is. Let's look at a few of these publications. The most read fake news story of the year comes from a website called abcnews.com.co. How many of you have ever seen that URL in your Facebook newsfeed? It's common. It's quite common. At first glance, the URL appears to be credible because you're drawn to the abcnews.com. As a consumer culture, we're predisposed to only examining what's ahead of the .com directory. And as a result, internet trolls have taken full advantage. For those who commonly consume and consume entertainment and tabloid news, TMZ is a popular information outlet. TMZhiphop.com, however, is not. It's an unaffiliated site that redirects to another site that traffics in even greater fictions than what are sometimes published by TMZ. Other publications in the top viewed fake news stories of 2016 include reputable sounding sites such as thebostontribune.com, thedenverguardian.com, christiantimes.com, and the Baltimore Gazette. The Boston Tribune has never existed, nor has the Denver Guardian. Now we'll notice that half of these site names are typically attached to fairly reputable news sources, right? The Chicago Tribune, the Guardian out of the UK. And so when we think about a news organization using them or pulling them together, it kind of makes sense, right? But maybe that's where we should first begin to question. The BaltimoreGazette.com is a newspaper that existed after the Civil War, but it hasn't existed in over a century until it popped up on the web as a generator of fake news. The web addresses themselves raise little question, and when the headlines such as Obama signs executive order declaring investigation into election results fit into your worldview, such stories become part of a national conversation, particularly on social media. I'll share a quick story. During the election cycle, a high school classmate of mine published something on Facebook, and it was from abcnews.com.co. Someone called her out, and she defended it vigorously. She said, "This is from ABC News. Look at the URL. It's from ABC News. Why would we not trust that?" Until somebody pointed out to her later in the comment feed that abcnews.com.co was a fake news site, right? Like most of us who've gotten lax in our media literacy for a digital age, she looked only at what was before the directory. And ABC News has been a trusted institution in most of our lives, for most of our lives. You see, we as a society become prone to attributing credit to social media distributors of content, rather than the content generators themselves. According to a survey by Pew Research Center, 62% of adults use social media to get their news. But those same 62% have some difficulty distinguishing between truth and lies. Since the 2016 election, President Obama has described the ecosystem of online news as a place in which everything is true and nothing is true. He's kind of diving into that philosophical conversation of truth and relative truth that I shadowed at the beginning of this talk. In an age where there's so much active information and it's packaged very well, Obama said, and it looks the same when you see it on your Facebook page or you turn on your television. If everything seems to be the same and no distinctions are made, then we don't know what to protect. Meaning, we don't know what to protect with the First Amendment. If we can't discriminate between serious arguments and propaganda, then we have a problem. Another survey by Pew Research Center found that 64% of adults surveyed said that fake news stories have caused a great deal of confusion about basic facts of current issues and events. This response, this confusion, occurred regardless of income, education level, or party affiliation, each of which are identified as key variables in the electoral decision-making process. Now, despite reported confusion related to the consumption of fake news, 4 in 10 people surveyed by Pew felt very confident that they could recognize a fake news story when they saw it. And another 45% felt somewhat confident in their ability to suss out fact from fiction. Now, that's the majority of people who are saying, on one hand, yeah, I'm confused when I see a story online. I'm confused about what is real and what is fake. But yet, there's still a majority of people who say, yeah, no, I can do it. I can do it. At the end of the day, I'll be able to figure it out. So why the dissonance? If people know a fake story when they see it, why does this content continue to play an increasingly central role in our civic conversation? The architects of social media are partially responsible. In November of last year, Facebook CEO Mark Zuckerberg offered this defense of his platform. He said, of all the content on Facebook, more than 99% of what people see is authentic. Only a very small amount is fake news and hoaxes. The hoaxes that do exist, he continued, are not limited to one partisan view or even to politics. But many critics disagree, as did a large group of Facebook employees who met secretly at Facebook in an attempt to address the fake news epidemic that infected Facebook during the 2016 election cycle. An anonymous spokesperson for the group told BuzzFeed that, quote, Zuckerberg knows, and those of us at the company know, that fake news ran wild on our platform during the entire campaign season. Both Facebook and its critics are careful to delineate between fake news, like the stories and sites I described earlier, and satire like that published by The Onion and The New Yorker's Borowitz report. Now, despite the apparent lack of corporate self-awareness at Facebook and other social media institutions, much of the onus for media literacy and the ability to distinguish between truth and lies still rests with us. It still rests with the consumer. In a few minutes, I'll return to the concept of media literacy and suggest some basic tools that all consumers and everybody in this room can use to sniff out odious tales on the web. Perhaps most disconcerting in the public's ability to identify fact from fiction has been the political class's willingness to exploit it. We're in the midst of an attempt to turn the Fourth Estate into public enemy number one. Politicians and the press have always had a relationship predicated upon the tension required for politicians to marshal information in the advance of their interests, as journalists seek to scrutinize, validate, or invalidate those claims. But those privileges and that understanding have eroded, due in no small part to the introduction of bloggers and full-time pundits into the operational mix. Since the mid-1990s, it's mostly been the citizen journalists, those who work within a narrow confine of a specialty niche without formal credentials or the backing of a prestigious organization. It's those who have attracted the ire of political operatives and professional journalists alike. But that chapter has closed, and a new paradigm has emerged. In this new era, legitimation of fringe media, legitimation of fake news, and internet trolls is not only a tactic employed as part of a greater political strategy, it may be the foundation of a coup d'etat that undermines the reverence for and relevance of a free press as imagined by our founders in the creation of this democratic experiment. Objectivity is now treated like a sin by the current political elite, exchanged instead for a subjective reality that favors only support for the administration's political will. In the 77-minute press conference that we saw clips from earlier, President Trump announced to a room full of mainstream media that, quote, the public doesn't trust you anymore. When reporters from the New York Times, NBC, and other stalwart media outlets raised questions about problematic communications with Russia that led to the resignation of National Security Advisor Michael Flynn, Trump responded, it's all fake news. You heard him earlier. It's all fake news. It's all fake news. The leaks are real, so the substance of the story is real. But the news is all fake. You're the one who wrote about them and reported it. I mean, the leaks are real, but the news is fake because so much of the news is fake. Fake news has become the mantra of this administration. It's a phrase inserted into official statements by the White House and the White House's spokespeople, and it's regularly used to identify mainstream media in the president's often stream of conscience Twitter feed. These are the last few tweets of February 17th and the first tweet of February 18th, in which the big three, the Gray Lady, the New York Times, and America's first 24-hour cable news network are clustered and rebranded as fake news. Perhaps what's more relevant to our discussion tonight is not the label affixed to the concept, but rather what happens to the data, the facts, used by news organizations to defend themselves and challenge the administration's official statements. Let's allow President Trump's senior advisor, Kellyanne Conway, the one who I debated in high school, to explain the use of alternative facts employed to refute actual facts, as she did last month on Meet the Press.
Then explain, you did not answer the question. Why did the president send out a new press secretary who's not just the spokesperson for Donald Trump? He can be. He also serves as the spokesperson for all of America at times. He speaks for all of the country at times. Why put him out there for the very first time in front of that podium to utter a provable falsehood? It's a small thing, but the first time he confronts the public, it's a falsehood?
Chuck, I mean, if we're going to keep referring to our press secretary in those types of terms, I think that we're going to have to rethink our relationship here. I want to have a great open relationship with our press, but look what happened the day before, talking about falsehoods. We allowed the press to come into the Oval Office and witness President Trump signing executive orders. And of course, you know, the Senate just confirmed General Mattis and General Kelly to their two posts, and we allowed the press in, and what happens almost immediately? A falsehood is told about removing the bust of Martin Luther King Jr. from the Oval Office. That's just flat out false. And the
full writers, immediately.
Why was it said in the first place? Because everybody is so presumptively negative. That reporter was writing on behalf of the press pool. That falsehood got spread 3,000 times before it was corrected.
Excuse, and you did not answer the question.
You did not answer
the question of why the president asked the White House press secretary to come out in front of the podium for the first time and utter a falsehood. Why did he do that? It undermines the credibility of the entire White House press office.
No, don't be so don't be so overly dramatic about it, Chuck. What you're saying is a falsehood, and they're giving Sean Spicer, our press secretary, gave alternative facts to that. But the point really is
alternative facts for the five facts he uttered. Look, alternative facts are not facts. They're falsehoods.
Chuck, do you think it's a fact or not that millions of people have lost their plans or health insurance and their doctors under President Obama? Do you think it's a fact that everything we heard from these women yesterday happened on the watch of Barack Obama? He was president for 8 years. Donald Trump's been here for about 8 hours. Do you think it's a fact that millions of women, 16.1 million women, as I stand here before you today, are in poverty along with their kids? Do you think it's a fact that millions don't have health care? Do you think it's a fact that we spent billions of dollars on education in the last 8 years, only to have millions of kids still stuck in schools that fail them every single day? These are the facts that I want the press corps to cover, and this is why I'm here at the White House.
I understand
to
this.
Change
what I don't
all
understand
the numbers
is,
like that.
That is not what yesterday was about. So you
yes,
did not answer the question. You did not answer the
it's
question.
It's what this presidency is going to be about.
You sent the press secretary out there to utter a falsehood on the smallest, pettiest thing.
I don't think anybody
and
can prove that. Look,
I actually don't think
that maybe this is me as a pollster, Chuck, and you know data well. I don't think you can prove those numbers one way or the other. There's no way to really quantify crowds. We all know that. You can laugh at me all you want, but I'm very glad. Well, but you are, and I think it's actually symbolic of the way we're treated by the press. The way that you just laughed at me is actually symbolic of the way, very representative of the way we're treated by the press. I'll just ignore it. I'm bigger than that. I'm a kind and gracious person.
Hey, easy news.
Record, I don't think I would have wanted to debate her in high school. Now, in a world of provable falsehoods and alternative facts, if you missed it, there was smoke that actually came out of Chuck Todd's ears at that point. Who can be trusted with what information? If all information is subject to provably falsehood checking, and alternative facts. How do we as committed, civically engaged citizens arm ourselves for info wars in the age of illiterate consumption? Of course, as always, as your teachers have been telling you since elementary school, you need to check your source. It's kind of ironic that in an age when it's easier than ever to check your source, that we have abandoned that practice, or so it seems. Is that source familiar to you? Is the source in the news story that you're reading someone that pops up all the time in your news cycle? Is this a common and familiar name? Is the site that you're getting your information from a site that you visit often? Or is it the first time you've clicked through it on Facebook or on Twitter? Is that site commonly reliable? And look closely, don't be fooled by sites designed to look like sites you trust, like abcnews.com.co. Read beyond the headlines. Oftentimes, there's enough evidence to suggest that a story may be fake. Too often, we catch ourselves reading the headline and either liking or sharing or retweeting that story without actually going in and reading it. A friend of mine suggested the other day there should be a little icon that pops up if someone shares without actually clicking through a story. I think that might not be a bad idea. Let's examine this headline from TMZhiphop.com. It says Chick-fil-A president Dan Cathy says, we don't like the blacks either. Now you guys remember the story of Chick-fil-A, right? It came out, Chick-fil-A as a company came out against gay marriage and engendered a lot of the public ire and backlash as a result. So here comes a story where they say, well, not only do we not like gays, but we don't like the blacks either. that story was not true, if you didn't get past the headline, if you didn't get past the URL, until you read this part of the story. We decided to focus on hate on African Americans after dismissing a proposal that would put actual AK-47s into kids' Happy Meals. Right? So now we're getting to the absurdity of the article. And in almost every fake news story, there is some element of absurdity. But you have to be willing to read it. You have to be willing to engage it. You have to see it in order to know. And the absurdity, of course, continues here in the headline. If the headline makes you think twice, the content will place your concerns at rest. And if the content is questionable, why share, right? If you're going to share this story, I would hope that it is with a comment at the top that says, check out this wild story, right? Look at this fake news. Think about the byline. Think about the author of the story. If there's no byline, there's probably no story. Many fake news sites publish stories by characters that have absurd first and last names. Things that sound like they might come from fantasy fiction. Or else they're just labeled by the site themselves. So if you're at abcnews.com.co, it'll say report by abcnews.com.co. If it doesn't tell you who wrote it, chances are good it doesn't actually exist. If the story seems too good to be true, too grand, Google the author to see if he or she has a reputation for doing really serious journalism. Because there are really great journalists out there in the world producing stories that you would read and think, oh my gosh, that's unbelievable. I can't believe that that's an actual story. But those people have a reputation for that kind of writing. They have a history of that kind of production, and you should be able to find it quite easily. Check for the dates of publication. If something sounds familiar, that may be because it already happened. Many fake news stories take a story and make it a year or 2 or 5 years old and recycle that story new and change the city in which the story took place. Or change the names of the people involved in the story and then expand upon that fiction. Search for key information points. Compare timelines. Do a Google search of an image address. Right? You right click on the image, you say copy image address, you put it into Google, and other images will come up in your Google search results that will probably take you to the original story from which those pictures were taken. And finally, check your biases at the door or the computer or wherever you happen to be. The survey by Pew found that despite the proliferation of fake news during the 2016 campaign cycle and the confusion that it caused, fake news had little effect on the outcome of the election because in most cases, it was confirming pre-existing biases rather than swaying public opinion. We want to hear things that reflect our own beliefs. We're naturally predisposed for this. And it's your opportunity to challenge that a little bit, to see things that challenge you. And there's a good chance that what you'll find is a greater defense of fact over fake news. We are our own best defense against fake news, whether it comes from an otherwise respectable media outlet or the President of the United States. We may not be able to stop its creation, but we should also not allow ourselves to be complicit in its dissemination. Thank you for your time and your attention tonight. I'm happy to entertain a couple of questions. And- And I've posted up here on the PowerPoint a couple of fact-checking sites that you can use and take away for your own enjoyment for research papers that you might be writing and to literally check everything that comes across your newswire. Thank you very much. Definitely continue to your pursuit to be a journalist, but you should know that journalism is one of the least respected professions in the United States. It used to be third behind lawyers and politicians, and in a recent survey about a year and a half ago, lawyers moved up the chart. So I think in some respects, the president and the political elite class in general is being successful in undermining the press. This idea that the press is somehow not trustworthy or unreliable, I think, is a generally distorted notion. Part of the problem is that the press doesn't always confirm our own biases, and so we assume that what we're hearing is unreliable information. But we know that in most cases, that's not the truth. We could argue and talk about the kind of content that's produced in the media and how valuable that is to us and our democratic process. But at the end of the day, even the softball news that's being thrown out is probably trustworthy.
Just a comment. Ed and I have been to the museum in Washington, D.C. a couple times. If anybody has an opportunity to get to Washington and go to the museum. It's a fairly new museum, but it's fascinating because it explores over time the evolution of journalism and various news media. And it's very heartwarming if you want to get into this field because it's all about really fine journalism. Journalists have given their lives in the pursuit of truth in all kinds of situations around the world. People who crave the truth, for example, behind the Berlin Wall, the wall was up, and how they would work so hard to get the truth and what was going on the other side of the wall. I have a friend in Turkey right now who's 40 years old. She went to school here in Erie. She's now over there, and we visited a year ago. And I asked these young people, how do you learn the truth over here? Because news is being suppressed. They triangulate it. They get it from as many sources as they can. They compare notes, and then they figure out what's really going on. So we're so fortunate. She tells me all the time, you're so lucky. You can assemble. You can get up and speak. You can do whatever. They can't.
Yeah, much of what we're facing today is an effect of taking that for granted for too long, not understanding that not enough people have access to the level of information that we do, and it seems on some level we're squandering it for unreal.
What is your opinion on, trying to think of how I want to phrase this, kind of YouTube, very accessible news outlets that are not actually news, like Stephen Colbert, Daily Show, Last Week Tonight with John Oliver, things like that. What's your take on those?
I mean, most of that falls into the category of satire, right? But even in that news, or even in those satirical productions, there is element of truth. There was a study out probably 2 or 3 years ago that looked at viewers of Colbert and The Daily Show, and what they found was that most people who viewed those programs were much more widespread consumers of actual news, right? right? They were well informed, because in order to get the joke, you had to know the story, right? So I think they serve an important role in our society, but again, you know, I think they're targeting a demographic of people who are trying to be informed. They're not necessarily putting out a fake product. People who don't have, who don't participate in the news cycle don't typically go to the Daily Show, I think, for their as their primary source.
When you were speaking on, you said there was no such thing as fake news. I was just wondering if you could elaborate on that on the basis of what makes there such a fake news.
Well, I mean, I think what I'm trying to do is to destroy that characterization, that title, right? It's just fake. It's just storytelling. It's just fiction, right? But to attach the term news to it does a disservice to news itself, right? Does a disservice to the idea that news is truthful and trustworthy. And so when we start talking about fake news, when we start criticizing the media as this kind of general catch-all term, I think it does go a long way to discrediting really great journalism that's happening. So that was my answer. Rob?
I'm a big believer in the tech, and certainly we're all carrying network dual camera devices on our person right now that are live, you know, technically speaking. And from what I've heard lately, we're going to lose the net, like the whole thing, for like a couple of weeks. And also the dark net is outpacing the good guys right now in their ability to hide and subvert data, such that they'll be untouchable in like a couple of years, maybe. And it's essentially a race to the finish to try to catch who these people that are trading data on the dark net. And that they say that we won't be able to do it because there's more money to be had there for the programmers. Is there a way that in the future you think we'll see us using our communicators, network devices, to help solve this lack of truth that is available to the public, like through an app or something? But that would be
I think it's still incumbent upon the user, right? You're not gonna have your phone in your hand and your phone ready to go, fake news alert, fake news alert. Not going to identify it for you.
But somehow we're all going to be carrying these, and we will all be the network. Much like you can hit a Lorax responder and be rescued anywhere in the world, your phone should be able to provide truth that is not accessible or that is missing, because somewhere the device recording everything crashed.
Well, I think what you're looking for is a filter to get rid of the BS, and I'm not sure that there's a consumer incentive or a capitalist imperative. Any other questions? Go ahead, Sam.
Do you think the difference in how certain stories are covered has an impact on people's trust of the news? So sometimes a network will cover a story in a completely different way than another one will. Sometimes another one won't cover the same story. Does that contribute to people's lack of trust, do you think?
I think so. We still hold on to this idea of opinion leaders in the media, and that's why you see the same stories on many media outlets. But I think at the end of the day, a variation in the way that a topic is presented is generally healthy, as long as it doesn't distort or subvert the facts of the story. So we need that. I mean, it's part of the competitive nature of the news business, right? To Mary Ellen's point, we would just have one news source. We would just have a state media if there was only one way to tell the story. And that certainly wouldn't be helpful to our democratic process either. Yes?
Just an observation.
I would agree, and I would encourage you all to do the same as well. Reach out to news sources from Canada, the UK, Al Jazeera, all great. great news sources. So thank you all for coming. If you need a if you need a slip to prove your attendance, please see Dr. Thompson. Thank you all.